Blackstone Publishing presents Defending Free Speech, selected commentary by the Ayn Rand Institute, edited and with an introduction and essays by Steve Simpson. Additional essays by Onkar Ghate, Elan Journo, and Leonard Peikoff. This book is read by Chris Abell. Introduction: A Battle of Ideas. Civilization depends on reason. Freedom means the freedom to think, then act accordingly. The rights of free speech and a free press implement the sovereignty of reason over brute force. If civilized existence is to be possible, the right of the individual to exercise his rational faculty must be inviolable. Leonard Peikoff, 1989. Freedom of speech is an essential pillar of Western civilization. Yet tragically, this precious right has come under increasing attack over the last few decades. In the fatwa against Salman Rushdie in 1989, the threats against Danish cartoonists in 2005 and 2006, and more recently the attacks on Charlie Hebdo in Paris and on a cartoon contest in Garland, Texas. While the chief perpetrators of the attacks have been Islamic totalitarians, the primary threat to freedom of speech is not existential but philosophical. Islamists are obviously motivated by ideas that are anathema to freedom of speech, but so increasingly are Western leaders and intellectuals who have repeatedly met these attacks not with a confident defense of Western values, but with apologies, appeasement, and victim blaming. For a glimpse of the source of these ideas, we need look no further than the universities, where students are taught a steady diet of irrationalism and emotionalism, self-sacrifice and multicultural tribalism. The results are predictable. Students increasingly seek trigger warnings before being taught controversial ideas. They seek refuge in safe spaces, and they rail against the ideals on which Western culture is based. In 2015, we saw the logical consequences of these ideas when students at the University of Missouri physically blocked a photographer from taking pictures of a protest held on public property, and one professor was caught on camera calling for some muscle to remove a student who refused to stop filming the protests. Meanwhile, our politicians increasingly use the muscle they possess, the power of physical force, which is the essence of government power, to threaten free speech directly, and to choke it off through the use of regulation and litigation. Recent examples include the IRS's targeting of Tea Party groups for attempting to speak out during the 2012 election cycle, the constant calls by politicians and intellectuals for greater controls on political speech in the form of campaign finance laws, demands that the United States enact European-style hate speech laws, and the investigations by state attorneys general of Exxon and various advocacy groups for challenging climate change orthodoxy. Ayn Rand spent much of her career writing about events such as these and the philosophical ideas and trends that produce them. In her article, Choose Your Issues, which appeared in the first issue of Objectivist Newsletter, she wrote, "Two enormously dangerous issues are creeping up on us, undiscussed, unopposed, and unfought. One to destroy intellectual freedom, the other to destroy economic freedom. The first was censorship. The second was rampant business regulation, most notably the antitrust laws." Rand urged her readers to educate themselves and speak out about these issues as they involve the fundamental principles of our culture. In her 1960 essay, For the New Intellectual, she elaborated on this point. Intellectual freedom cannot exist without political freedom. Political freedom cannot exist without economic freedom. A free mind and a free market are corollaries. At the Ayn Rand Institute, we have carried on the defense of both intellectual and economic freedom that Rand began over 50 years ago. The current volume is a collection of our recent writings, published on our website and as op-eds on the subject of free speech. With one exception, all the pieces have been published since 2003. The exception, which serves as a prologue to the essays in Part 1 of the book, is Leonard Peikoff's article on our government's shameful response to the fatwa against Salman Rushdie. In 2009, 2 decades after the incident, the writer Bruce Bauer would note in his book Surrender that there were precious few of us who grasped at the time of the Rushdie fatwa that here was indeed a new form of jihad on the world scene, and that Islamists presented a grave threat to intellectual freedom. Peikoff grasped it in 1989, shortly after Iran's Ayatollah Khomeini issued the fatwa, and Western governments did nothing. His piece, which ran in the New York Times as a full-page advertisement, is a philosophical tour de force, a grave warning of what will happen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.